Very quick introduction of myself. I'm actually a professor at the Calgary University, and my specialty is information systems engineering. I'm currently visiting UCL University of London as a student professor with an interaction center. There's more to this, but I don't want to take more time on that. Right, let me just tell you sort of a personal story about where all this came about. When I first started studying in the UK, my first master's was actually in systems analysis and design, which dealt with a lot of methodology for developing information systems. So I guess my foundational skill really is in the area of systems analysis, which Tom talked to us today about what sort of horrible mistakes they made, so I'll go along with that, that's fine. Systems analysts traditionally define a set of requirements that are required of a system, and henceforth the global over-architecture of how that works. I then went to study for my PhD at Brunel University, and I taught at the same time. I taught software engineering, I taught information systems subjects, and as I was finishing my PhD, I got hugely drawn into architecture, like proper architecture, buildings architecture. I was teaching software engineering, so I thought, well, maybe there are parallels here in terms of the design concepts and methodology between what software engineers do and what architects do. Or at least that was the excuse I gave to my head of department to give me permission to study architecture. It worked. I took along an article that said something about the parallels or the architectural discipline being a base discipline or principal discipline, reference discipline rather, for MIS, which is Management Information Systems. Off I go. My head of department gave me permission to go off one day a week to study architecture at the University of Greenwich. He even paid for my fees for the first year. As I was finishing that particular degree in architecture, I got a job at UCL, a senior research fellow, the Bartlett School of Architecture, one of the best in the country. It's just around the corner, so I decided to enroll for another one in Advanced Architectural Studies, which they later renamed as Spatial Design. So I guess I'm privileged to have actually seen both worlds at a very close view. And then I started to have a little bit of an argument with the software engineering community. Let me tell you what happened. The software engineering community started to talk about software architectures, yeah? In terms of principles on components and connectors and things like that. But when I did that at master's at City University in systems analysis and design, I was actually exposed to a particular methodology in systems design called JSD, Jackson Systems Development. For me, that actually did exhibit a software architecture that is not merely components and connectors, not just modules. Obviously, anyone who studies software architecture would say something about things like modular independence, coupling and cohesion, yeah, making systems robust against change, modular, flexible, changeable, adaptable, that sort of stuff, right? So let me tell you what really drew my attention here to JSD. JSD, the philosophy, it's a very old methodology, we talked about like 30 years ago. But the idea was, do not start with researching the requirements. Do not start by asking what the requirements of the system are. Start with asking, what is the fundamental mission of the system? What is the system there to do? And start your modeling from there. I was talking to some people earlier about modeling and where to start modeling and stuff like that. So if we start modeling the fundamental, the subject matter of the system, we have better capability of implying a number of functions that are not explicitly mentioned or hardwired into the model. Which really means that when the system changes function, when there are requirements changes, you don't have to mess about with the very foundational models you've developed in the first place. This is very similar to what happened later in terms of object-oriented methodologies. In fact, there were papers saying, you know, is JSD the first or the original object-oriented methodology? Because later on, we can plug in, if you like, at a different layer, a different architectural layer, we can plug in functions that are hardwired to the what the business needs now, what are the applications that are needed, which varies according to markets, space, business strategies, and so on. But the basic entity is the core entity, the model kind of component, if you like, thinking in terms of an MVC pattern, are more or less stable. They live long. They live longer than anything else. And then comes another layer about perhaps interface, maybe security, maybe filters, maybe things like that that are more transient, more easily changed. Rolled forward to architecture again. The purpose of this slide is to show something nice, that's all. Just a nice architecture that I like by John Pulse. As I started to study architecture, I came across a view by an architectural theorist called Stuart Brand, who wrote a book about how buildings learn and how they adapt across their lives. Yeah? He referred to this particular set of buildings in San Francisco. Obviously, these are Victorian buildings here for us to recognize them here because we live in the UK, we see these a lot. And he spoke about how these buildings lived for 200 plus years, pleasant, loved by their owners, easily accommodating a variety of functions. And we'll see how these Victorian buildings can be split up into flats, you know, a clinic at the bottom and something else, an office at the top, stuff like that, without really incurring a major cost of change to suit or adapt to new functions. So in essence, because of some good architectural decisions that were made, whether these were conscious or not conscious decisions, they've accommodated a range of possible or implied functions that were not thought of when these buildings first went up. So that's the idea, really. The architecture implied, generated, they were generative of potential. And that's what I'm really interested in architecture. Another sort of more theoretical teasing out of how this happened is in this diagram, if you bear with me a little bit. He says, well, in any buildings, in traditional buildings, that is, because I will talk later about non-traditional buildings, we have the site layer, which is sort of the foundational, the least changing, or the hardest to change layer, stays stable as long as the building is there. Therefore, it's heavy, thick, there are no arrows on it. Next layer up, we have the structure, the thing that holds the building or any artifact, the fact you can think of, up to, you know, to withstand various loads, earthquakes, whatever. And this is obviously not only hard to change at the site, but is still relatively hard to change, and so on and so forth. So we have the skin layer, maybe the cladding outside, things that are weatherproofing, etc., etc., waterproofing and what have you. And then the surfaces layer, which is easily to change in the skin, and the infrastructure layer, or the structure layer, if you like. Piping, ventilation, water, sewage, etc., etc., electricity. Going up further, still the space plan. I can actually see an example of that right here. Yeah, early in the morning, this was a big hall, was a big one, big room. Very easy to manage to change the space plan to suit a different use, but obviously this use was already foreseen. You could actually predict that this would happen one day. And last is the fastest changing, the easiest changing. Look here, I'll put it in two terms, fast and easy. Yeah, fast because people tend to require changes in this layer more often than others. Maybe if they require more changes in other layers, we've seen different architectures. Yeah, so there's the question of what the user or the business or the domain requires in terms of which part of the architecture needs to be flexible and easy to change. And it so happens this is actually very easy to change. By stuff, we mean things like maybe chairs, the projector, the flip trap, the display from the outside, a podium, etc., etc., decoration of the wall, lighting, and so on and so forth. So, back to sort of trying to theorize this a bit in terms of what we do. Well, Brent says, well, these buildings are adaptable because we have loosely coupled layers of construction elements. I'm not saying construction elements here. Otherwise, we would be talking about a loose coupling between dash and bricks, maybe. Yeah, actually, very maybe.
Limestone.
Yeah. The actual fabric of the building. That's not what I mean. What he means is that the layers, the constructional layers, can actually slip past each other without affecting the other one. So it could actually fit a new light without having to remove a structural column, perhaps, or a structural element in the building. You can change the furniture without having to change the space plan necessarily, and so on and so forth. So if you want to make your building or your artifact or your system to be adaptable, you need to allow certain layers, certain constructional layers, categories, to slip past each other without affecting each other. And I stress the concept of layer here, or categories of elements, because we're not talking functional independence of individual bits and pieces. But I have to point out something very important, is that this is actually a normative model. What does that mean? It means it's based on how buildings traditionally use buildings. Sorry, people traditionally use buildings, and users traditionally use buildings. Because they tend to require changes in the stuff layer much more often than others, and therefore wants to be easier and faster and relatively cheap to effect. So in my arguments with the software engineering community, I was saying, look you guys, what you're talking about is not architecture. If you talk about this level, like how to fit a window to a wall, that's structure. That's not architecture. So architecture is when you start thinking about things like that, and we had talks like this today from Tom and other people about how these layers need to be global, long-term, coarse-grained. So maybe this diagram is also useful. So this is what will be an architect would be thinking like. Keep coming back. Okay. And then this one. And in doing architecture, actually look very carefully at the context, analyze the context. And I'm pleased to have one of my colleagues and friends here telling me that the graduate of the part like architecture books are actually an architect, because he designed the buildings. So keep looking around the building. This stairs, how it's affected by its surroundings, where do you look, what can you see if you stand there outside and vice versa, where is it seen from as you approach what you see and things like that. So this is really important. Now,
sorry, that seems to be superficial, not structural. How it looks and how where you can see it is nothing to do with the structure itself in terms of the quality and what you can do with it. It's a nice thing to have. It doesn't really affect it. But sheltering from the rain, you don't care what it
is. Yeah, of course, this is just one of the things to think about, but you have to think about other things as well. For example, climate, environment, sustainability, which is one of the things that came up today, innovation. So just giving one example of the type of global thinking you need to do, but this does, and visual aspects is one of them, but it's not all of them. So there are a number of things. I'm just really referring to the level of thinking, the level of reasoning. It's coarse-grained, it's global, it's strategic, and so on. So that's really the idea. You need to think of kind of categories that can change or not change with the speed that is required by the user and the individual domain. So if you just let me carry on a little bit, as I said here in one of the slides, that this was a normative model. It's based on how people traditionally think about buildings. But in another book on, again discussing things like architecture by someone called Kenneth Frampton, who's an architectural theorist, he takes us across the world to see examples of how these architectonics, if you like, are reversed, are turned upside down. Examples from Africa, other communities and so on. And maybe this example would be best if I just show you what happens here if you're thinking in terms of a nomad's tent. Yeah, if you're thinking of a tent, the site actually becomes the most changeable part of the entire artifact, isn't it? Because the nomad would want to just wrap up the whole thing, put it on their camel or llama or whatever, and move somewhere else. And in that case, what perhaps is the most foundational, the longest living, I'm just guessing here, and like maybe you agree with me, is the actual skin. Because this is the thing that is expensive. It's made of camel or animal hair, and it takes a long time to weave and stuff like that. So actually, it's long living, even longer than the structure, which would be the sort of sticks or poles that keep the thing standing up. So though this kind of layering from site to stuff seemed to make sense, perfect sense in one particular context, one particular domain or society, it is reversed. It is radically altered when you look at a different kind of community or domain. So this really means we need to, if we're going to make decisions like these about systems, and we need to think about certain required features like adaptability over time, flexibility, accommodating new requirements. We need to think in terms not just of structuring everything in the same way that we've seen in one system. For example, assuming that the data is maybe the most foundational thing, and we need to look at the data first and then plug in or fix some function on top of that, and interface, etc., etc. We really need to understand the domain. Is the domain of the problem that we're looking at, namely the enterprise that we're trying to architect, more like a tent, like conventional urban dwelling, as a traditional building, as we're doing now? So really this sensitivity about coming up with an optimal layering, or suitable layering for a particular domain and context are really important. Now this slide again is from the same book by Brand about if we're going to have this, let's think about a number of potential scenarios, a number of potential change scenarios. And it has an entire chapter entitled the scenario buffer building. Yeah, so looking at across a number of potential futures, if you like. I'm not going to say anything about how to come up with these futures. Obviously there are other methods for that, and maybe methods for weighing them and giving them relative weights and giving them numeric values. As Tom Gibb was discussing earlier today, but the idea is you need to think about a range of possibilities that might actually before you bid me, and then make the best set of architectural decisions that would actually suit this building. I'm just trying to look at some notes actually that I made earlier. Sorry, maybe I left it on the So I've improvised a few things based on the presentation that I attended earlier today, and some of the things that were, I think, relevant to the set of relevant to what I'm saying today is what came up in Tom's presentation about architectures and the links to quality and requirements. I hope you agree with me that one of the most fundamental jobs of an architecture is to connect architectures, requirements to actual designs, in particular the non-functional requirements. Because because you can have what sometimes can be called a range of computationally equivalent architectures or systems. They all do the same function, as in hard functions, as in non-functional, as in functional requirements. But from the non-functional point of view, they are differentiated. One is more secure, one is faster, one is more adaptable, etc., etc. So architecture for us is the key in reasoning in this way and in connecting the requirements to the non-functional qualities of the system. I learned that from your book, Tom, a long time ago. Right? And actually, in his book, Tom mentioned something about you enable this evolutionary model, which in which you actually develop little increments of the system. Yeah, obviously, yeah, this is Agile 4, but many, many years ago. Little increments of the system based on having a global open architecture. So if you have a global open architecture, you can do very good Agile, which is based on proper architecture that is not just satisfying or meeting current requirements. Yeah, that are aiming to satisfy potentially a range of requirements that have not been seen or predicted by anyone who's trying to gaze into a crystal ball and try to think what the system is going to be doing in the future. Yeah, so the idea of an open global architecture comes from this kind of thinking: what is my tent like? What is my what is my model of the building like? Where are the flexibilities? Where is the part flexibility? You cannot have infinite flexibility. Yeah, you still have to have your cores, and that was part of what Christine mentioned today in her presentation. That you need to have this sort of platform, this core that is stable, on which you can develop other things. But obviously, the difficult thing is how do you know which bits are the core? Which bits are core? I guess this is a subject of another presentation entirely, but at least it's an issue that we think about. This is about stable platform. I'm just looking at the notes I made literally like an hour ago on the presentation that I made. Richard Barton also mentioned things about fixed assets and sunken costs. Okay, we're all excited about Agile, and we want to do things in iteration and be very flexible and maneuverable and change direction and stuff like that if the requirements change. But essentially, you still have to make pretty costly infrastructure decisions. You would have some sunken costs. You would have to lay some cables down. So which cables do you lay, figuratively speaking? Which ones are your cables? Which ones are the equivalents of the site and the infrastructure layers? Again, this takes a certain kind of analysis that is not functional. It's not about asking the business leaders what they want to do or what the strategy are. We need to help them as enterprise architects of discovering the flexibility points. Is it the skin? Or is it the space bar? Or is it the site that needs to be flexible? In your particular case, one of the things I did also at the university is that I assumed the role of innovation chair for the university. Let me just show you just one more diagram before I move on to this bit of innovation, which I literally added like a few minutes ago. Kenneth Hampton said, well, from ethnographic studies of buildings around the world, we've always found that any buildings will have these two modes, these fundamental two modes of buildings for construction. One is the stable and one is the volatile. Yeah? And he calls it the stereotomics of the earth, the sort of round earth, the stable earth that doesn't move. Which I would call a culture, maybe. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Again, the word culture came up several times. We interchange cultures from people to architect.
Yeah.
And then the upper part, which is the tectonic frame, the flexible, the maneuverable, the malleable frame, the transient, the thing that you can change more easily. As two foundational modes, or maybe you have more things in between. Yeah, between the very stable, the highly stable, the immovable, and the highly changeable, etc. Now, in my training on innovation, we did something like that. When I was helping companies define what is the next innovative move, what is the next product that's going to take the world by storm, maybe the next Facebook or the next iPhone, there's this business about, okay, find out what is your company's sandbox, what are your traditional strengths, where you have the muscles, where you have the expertise that has already been accumulated over a number of years, and then based on that, perhaps use these as a platform, stepping stone to step into a different field, but don't jump into the sea, as it were, without any stable thing to hold on to. So if you define where are the pivotal points on which you can springboard onto the next innovation or the next thing. So for example, we could say something like if you're working with feeding animals, if the company is traditionally feeding animals, feeding humans, right? It's a food company, it's a food and beverage or food processing company. Maybe the next step is going to rely on your ability to feed humans and develop maybe the next kind of food for animals, maybe for cars, where you can start developing biofuels and so on. So in a sense, the next step in your innovation strategy is partially defined for you because you've studied your strength very carefully. You've studied your site, you've studied your domain. So if you study your domain really hard, you can reasonably accurately define which things, which directions you can step into without incurring too much cost for your company. So really, this is like more of an attempt to sort of provoke thoughts and stimulate discussion about how do we approach our architectural tasks, how do we do architectural design in terms that will make the system have certain desired attributes. Of course, I've based the presentation on the attribute of being flexible and adaptable, but maybe it's something completely different than we want. And again, this comes from how we study the domain. Maybe it's not adaptability and flexibility that is the most prized in our particular domain and particular problem situation, maybe it's something else. Maybe it's security, maybe it's speed. But at least we need to think very hard about what are they, the range of quality attributes that we want our architecture to support, and then use that to move forward. But certainly it's not a question of one size fits all, it's a question of studying the domain very carefully. Thank you very much.
No, I'm next speaker.
Oh, okay.